Carles Llore, de Juan Llore, de l'Escalatua.
Vale.
Pots fer xerrant?
No sé. Va bé.
Tenies les setems of flow?
Segurament no.
Perquè, sí, el projecte, primer expliquem coses, però després hi ha una estona allà, si estàs per allà pol·lulant.
Vale. Vale, entre 4 i 5.
Sí.
Vale.
Com
això? Sí.
Let's go.
Okay, good morning. This is Carles Ventura and I'm going to present my thesis titled Visual Object Analysis Using Regions and Local Features, co-advised by Xavier Giro and Veronica Vilaplana, and tutorized by Ferran Marquez. So the outline of this presentation is divided in two main parts with a previous introduction and some general conclusions in the end. Each of these parts will consist of five following subsections: introduction, related work, contributions, experiments, and conclusions. So first of all, I would like to introduce the application that will connect both parts of this thesis, that is the semantic segmentation problem. This problem is divided in two different subproblems. One that is called the instant segmentation, where the goal is identifying each instance of an object, and the other one that is the class segmentation, where the goal is assigning each pixel of the image a class label. In this thesis, we will focus on the latter problem, the class segmentation problem. So, whereas the first part of this thesis will address the problem when only a single image is provided, the second part addresses the semantic segmentation problem when for multi-view sequences. So, for sets of images which have been taken from different viewpoints in the same scenario at the same time. So here we have an example where some state-of-the-art semantic partitions have been obtained by applying the technique independently for each of the views, like in the first part. And the result proposed by us, where we have exploited the spatial correlation that exists between the different views. So let me introduce the title of this thesis: Visual Object Analysis Using Regions and Local Features, which can be mainly divided into three different blocks. Visual Object Analysis, because this thesis is focused on objects like cars, persons, or bugs, in contrast to other things which are referred to as stuff, like sky, road, trees, seawater. The second block is regions, which will be used for analyzing the objects. Images are divided into segments called regions, which are a result of applying segmentation algorithms. In particular, in this thesis, we have used hierarchical segmentation algorithms, so we have partitions at different resolutions. So, as a result, there exist relationships between the different hierarchical relationships between the regions, which can be represented by a binary partition tree, where the leaf nodes represent the regions in the partitions and the internal or parent nodes represent the mergings of their children nodes. Another concept related with regions is the region adjacency graph, which is a graph where each node represents a region and two nodes are connected if the regions that they represent are adjacent. The third block of the title is local features, which have been also used for analyzing the objects. We have we want to differentiate local features, which are extracted at local patches from like shift descriptors, from global features that are computed over the whole image, for instance, intensity histograms for that image, like this one. Although local features are extracted over local patches, these local features can be aggregated over regions or even over the whole image. So there exist aggregation techniques. One of the most popular is the backup features, where each local feature from an image is assigned to the most similar visual feature from a codebook and aggregated to a histogram where each component is the number of occurrences of that code word from the codebook. Another aggregation technique is the pooling, which have been used in the first part of this thesis, that we can mainly differentiate two popular techniques: the first order average pooling, where the local features are simply average, and the second order average pooling, where the average is done over the outer product of the local features. So the advantages of pooling are that there's no need of a training database to obtain a codebook, and there's no need to decide a size of a codebook. On the other side, the drawbacks is the high dimensionality of the aggregated vector, especially in the case of the second order pooling. So let's move to the first part, context analysis in semantic segmentation. First of all, I will introduce the concept of context. We can differentiate two types of context: the semantic context and the spatial context. In the semantic context, the objects are analyzed independently, and then the predicted labels are post-processed, taking into account how likely is that the set of predicted labels occur in the same image. So for instance, since lemon is not likely to be here, this label is replaced by tennis ball because it's more likely. The other context, the spatial context, refers to the spatial extension over which the local features are aggregated, like just the yellow pixels of the tennis ball, the tennis ball and some surrounding pixels, and so on. The spatial context can be extended to a certain point. So the goal of this first part of the thesis is analyze the influence of the spatial context in object recognition. So let's review some related words where the context has been used in semantic segmentation. The first word I would like to highlight is the visual extent of an object, where the authors consider an ideal scenario where the ground truth object locations are provided. So they perform an analysis on the classification performance depending on the local features are only aggregated over the object, or over the surround, or over both the object and surround, and then concatenated these aggregated features. So they found that the last configuration, object and surround separately and concatenated, gave the best performance. They also introduced a third region, the border around the object, and for this spatial configuration, the interior border and surround increase more the performance. The second word I like to highlight is the object recognition as ranking holistic figure ground hypothesis, where the authors consider a realistic scenario And they use object hypotheses or object candidates instead of the ground truth locations. So they proposed the following pipeline that has been used in the first part of this thesis, where we have an input image, some object candidates are generated, then they are ranked according their object plausibility. For each object candidate, a regressor is applied to estimate the likelihood of each class, and the candidates are then ranked, and the highest rank are aggregated to the final semantic partition. So, how is the regressor trained? We have a training data for each semantic class. So, for instance, let's focus on the boost class. Okay, we have an image and the ground truth of the boost. So, we extract different object candidates, and for each object candidate, the local features are aggregated over the figure, the object mask, and the ground, the rest of the image. And these aggregated feature vectors are associated to an overlap score, which is given by the overlap between the object candidate and the ground truth masks. So this is done for each object candidate for that image, and also for each image in the training dataset. So again, for each object candidate with the overlap scores. So with all these feature vectors, a super vector regressor is trained in a way that we estimate a function that predicts the overlap score. And our goal in the first part of this thesis is changing this spatial codification to improve the segmentation performance. So our contributions will be trying different spatial configurations for aggregating the local features. Our first proposal is extending the figure border ground spatial pooling to the realistic scenario. So given an image and an object candidate, the image is divided in three different regions. The object, well, the figure in red, the border in green, and the ground in blue, and the local features are aggregated over these three different regions. And the concatenation of these three aggregated vectors over the figure, the border, and ground are used to train the support vector regressor. Another contribution is enriching the spatial codification of the figure, region. So we proposed a contour-based spatial pyramid. A spatial pyramid has been classically applied to over an image or over bounding boxes, and to our best knowledge, this is the first time that it's used for regions of arbitrary shape. So we propose two different configurations. One is the Chrome-based spatial pyramid, where the figure region is divided in four different grounds, and the local features are aggregated over each of these subregions, and also over the whole figure region. So we have the support vector regressor that now is trained with the aggregation, with the concatenation of these five aggregated feature vectors. And the other configuration for the contour-based spatial pooling for a spatial pyramid is a Cartesian-based spatial pyramid, where given an image and an object candidate, we divide the configuration in four subregions, top left, top right, bottom left, and bottom right. And we aggregate the local features over these four subregions, and as well as the whole configuration. So the support vector regressor is trained with these aggregated local features. The experiments have been performed in the following benchmark: the Pascal Visual Object Categories Segmentation Challenge 2011 and 2012, where the dataset is divided in three different subsets: train, validation, and test. And the pixels are classified as one of the 20 semantic classes defined in this benchmark, or as background. The evaluation measure that has been used is the average accuracy classification, which is defined in this benchmark. So the first experiments have been performed in an ideal scenario where the object, the ground truth mass, are used to train the models and also to predict, to perform the predictions. So the ground truth mass are not provided for the test subset. So we decided to train the models using the train subset and using the validation subset for testing. We have this table shows the results using two different feature types, the rich shift and the rich mass shift, and four different spatial pooling configurations: just the figure, figure and border, figure and ground, and figure, border, and ground. So I like to highlight that we can see that just using the border gives a performance that it's greater than using the whole background, but the background still carries useful information, as can be seen in the configuration where we use the figure, the border, and also the ground, the rest of the background. So we have performed the experiment for the spatial pyramids. Have done this experiment with three different configurations: figure, figure border, and figure border and ground. And note that the spatial pyramid is only applied over the figure region, even when border and ground regions are also considered. So when we only use figure to train the models and predict the model and to predict the categories, the ground-based spatial pyramid gives the best performance, but it's the Cartesian-based spatial pyramid, the one that outperforms the other techniques when border and ground are also considered. Finally, in the ideal scenario, we have performed the experiments combining the three different local feature types: the enriched shift, the enriched mass shift, and the enriched local binary pattern. So using the figure border ground configuration, we increase the performance about 1 point, and also including the Cartesian based spatial pyramid, we increase the performance about 3 points. Then the experiments, once validated in the ideal scenario, have been also performed in the realistic scenario using the CPMC object candidates. So first, I would like to highlight that when only enriched is used, including the border increases the performance about 6 points. Second, when only enriched is used, but border and also the spatial pyramid are used, the performance is slightly better than the one from the original work that uses the combination of the three different feature types. And third, when we use both border and spatial pyramid and the combination of the three different feature types, we achieve 39.6 of performance. We have also performed the experiments using the train and validation subsets for training and the test for testing, and the performance increased significantly when the figure border ground is used for both challenges 2011 and 2012. But in contrast to the previous experiments, the use of the spatial pyramid results in a decrease of the performance, which we think that is due to an overfitting problem. However, we have also validated the both proposals using another object candidate generation algorithm, the multi-scale combinational grouping, MCG. And despite the decrease in the performance with respect to the CPMC, the both proposals, the figure border ground and the use of the spatial pyramid, increases the performance with respect to the original figure ground spatial pooling. So here we have some qualitative results. There's one example for each semantic class from Pascal. And the column in the middle of each figure is the result when the figure ground spatial pooling, the original one, is used. And the third column are the results for our proposed figure border ground pooling. We can see some examples like the aeroplane that is not recognized in the original pooling and well recognized in our proposed pooling. And another, like the bird example, where it's well recognized in the figure border ground pooling, but recognized as a cat in the original figure ground pooling. Here we have another examples for the rest of the semantic classes from Pascal. So to end the first part, we have drawn the following conclusions. Figure border ground spatial pooling improves the original figure ground pooling in both ideal and realistic scenarios. The border region pool covers the richest contextual information. The Cartesian-based spatial pyramid outperforms the crown-based spatial pyramid, but both of them may result in overfitting. And both figure border ground pooling and Cartesian-based spatial pyramid have been validated with MCG object candidates. This first part of the thesis has been published in the last edition of the International Conference on Image Processing. So let's move now to the second part, multi-resolution co-clustering for uncalibrated multi-view segmentation. As introduced at the beginning of the presentation, the second part tackles the segmentation problem for multi-view sequences. So in this part, we show how the semantic segmentation can be improved when multi-view sequences are considered, that are sets of images that have been taken from different points in the same scenario and at the same time. So we have some state-of-the-art results for generic segmentation, not semantic segmentation. And the goal of generic segmentation is that regions are consistent along the different views. So if a region changes its color from one view to another view, means that these regions are not being recognized as the same region. For instance, we can see how the structure of the chair changes its color from one view to the another one. So our first goal in the second part is improving the generic segmentation for multi-view sequences. So the other problem that we want to focus is on semantic segmentation. So here we have the results that are obtained with state-of-the-art techniques, which have been applied independently for each of the views. So we want to exploit the spatial correlation that exists between the different views. And for that reason, one of the things that is important is also the first goal, that is improving the generic segmentation to have good relations between the different views. So we propose a semantic segmentation where we exploit this correlation, this spatial correlation between the different views, and our results, the chair is better represented than in the state of the art results. So our first goal is improving the generic segmentation. Some contributions have been done in for this goal and will be developed later. And the second goal is improving the semantic segmentation with the following contributions. So in order to obtain a generic segmentation for multi-view sequences, we can use three different families of segmentation techniques. The first of them is the cosegmentation techniques, which classically address the problem of pairs of images with same instance objects but different backgrounds. These techniques have evolved, and now current techniques of cosegmentation also addresses the segmentation problem for sets of images with similar backgrounds and also for video sequences. Another family is the video segmentation techniques, which addresses the problem of segmentation for video sequences, and the co-clustering techniques, which can be divided in two subfamilies, the region-based co-clustering and the contour-based co-clustering. Since one work of last year found that contour-based co-clustering was the best of these techniques for multi-view for video segmentation, we have performed we will review this contour-based co-clustering, and we propose some contributions to extend this framework for multi-view sequences. So, first of all, let me review the contour-based co-clustering framework. Given a set of images where we have the leaf partitions, the objective is to find the clusters that define the coherent regions across the different views. So, for instance, in this example, we found a cluster C1 that is formed by regions R1 and R2 from view 1 and R4 and 5 from the second view, and a second cluster C2 that is formed by R3 and R6. Okay? So in this co-clustering framework, it is used a representation with boundary variables. These boundary variables can be divided in two groups. The intra-image boundary variables, which defines boundaries between regions from the same partition, like between R1 and R2, that would be defined as D1-2. And the inter-image boundary variables, which define boundaries between regions from different partitions, like between region 1 and region 4, that would be defined as D1-4. If a boundary variable, a boundary variable is a Boolean variable. So if it's set false, means that the boundary is inactive. That means that both regions belong to the same cluster. For instance, D1-2 that connects these two regions is inactive because they belong to the same cluster. Okay, And the otherwise, boundary variables are set active if the regions are do not belong to the same cluster, like D1-3, because regions 1 and 3 belongs to different clusters. So how are the values of these boundary variables chosen? Using a, well, solving a minimization problem, where each boundary variable dij is multiplied by an element q that encodes the similarity between these regions I and j. Okay, so the similarity value is computed on two different ways, depending on both regions are coming from the same partition, which are referred to as intra-image interactions, or they come from different partitions, which are referred to as inter-image interactions. There are some constraints that are applied to the minimization problem. One of them are the hierarchical constraints. So the hierarchical constraints force that the co-clustering solutions cannot violate the hierarchical structures associated to each of the partitions. Okay? So for instance, this would be a valid co-clustering solution, because cluster 1 consider regions 1 and 2 that can be merged in the 3, in the 3, and so on. But here we have an example of a not valid solution, okay? So if we change the hierarchy and regions 1 and 3 are merged first and then merged to region 2, and we have this solution, we have that cluster 1 considers regions 1 and 2, which they can only be merged if they are also merged to region 3, which is not the case, because region 3 belongs to a different cluster. Another constraint is also imposed in the co-clustering framework to generate solutions at different resolutions. So, given a different values to the T sub R parameter, we obtain different resolutions, solutions at different resolutions, okay? And finally, in the co-clustering framework, since a global optimization is not feasible where all the views are jointly processed, due to the high number of boundary variables involved in the optimization process, the original co-clustering framework implements an iterative approach where the segmentation of a particular view depends only on the segmentation of the two previous co-cluster partitions. Okay, so the segmentation for V4 depends on the leaf partitions of segmentations 3 and 4, and also the co-clustering partitions from this blue line that comes from the solution from the second view, and this orange line that comes from the solution for the third view. So let's once review the original framework, I would like to introduce our own contributions to this framework. The first contribution is a redefinition of the region adjacency graph based on motion queues. So here we have detected a problem that it's given a pixel of one of the views. If we place that element in the same location in another view, the pixel is from the background, not from the code. So we propose to use optical flow to motion compensate the images before computing the co-clustering. Okay, and when optical flow it's used, we obtain the pixel where it was expected. So the use of motion cues affects the inter-image relationships. How? The contour elements from one of the view are motion compensated before being compared with the contour elements from the other view, and also the regions from one view are motion compensated before deciding to which regions from the other view the regions are adjacent. Okay? So the second contribution is a new resolution parameterization. So given this example with this pair of these partitions, we have several co-clustering solutions at different resolutions. Okay, and let's suppose that we want a particular resolution, this one that has two clusters. So using the original parameterization, it's not clear which value we should use for the parameter T sub pair. So we propose a new resolution parameterization where the parameter N sub R is directly the number of clusters that we want for that resolution. The third contribution is a two-step iterative architecture. The reason is that the original framework uses one only step architecture, where we have found some problems like this one, that it's the co-cluster partition from this view, the clusters A and C cannot be merged into a single cluster like the other views, because the hierarchy do not allow them. Okay, we can see that we would like to merge regions 5, 6, and 8 to form a single cluster, but to merge 5, 6, and 8, it can only be done if it's also merged with 7. So we propose to remove the hierarchical constraints, but in a second step. So using now this new partition, we applied a new minimization problem, and we obtained in the second step the desired co-cluster solution. Okay, so here we have an example where we have these two views of a teddy bear, and we have the problem detected in the first step. The body and the head have not been clustered in the same cluster like in the other view. But when we remove the hierarchical constraints in the second step, both head and body parts have been jointly clustered. So this is the architecture for the proposed two-step iterative architecture, the flowchart, sorry. So we have that to obtain the partitions at the second step, we applied the same minimization problem that is used in the co-clustering framework, but using the partition resulting from the first step instead of the initial list partitions, and without the hierarchical constraints. Okay. So let's move to the fourth contribution, that it's a generic global co-clustering, where we want to allow the system to have a global optimization over all the views. This wasn't feasible at the beginning due to the high number of regions on the list partitions, but we propose to use the global optimization over the partition resulting after the two-step iterative architecture. So the reduction on the number of regions makes the global optimization feasible. The fifth contribution is a semantic global co-clustering, where in this global optimization that we have proposed before, now we also introduce semantic information that are semantic partitions coming from state-of-the-art techniques applied independently on each image to obtain a new co-clustering solutions where objects are better represented with a smaller number of clusters, like the chair. If we compare, we can see more clearly here that this is the result from the generic co-clustering from the two-step architecture. And when we include this semantic segmentation in the global optimization process, we obtain this semantic co-clustering. Okay, so our sixth contribution is an automatic resolution selection. We have said that we have a multi-resolution, a resolution parameterization. So, given some list partitions, we have solutions at different resolutions. Okay. So, the problem here is that some applications requires a single resolution, like semantic segmentation. So, how should we choose one of these resolutions if I only want to choose one? So we propose a method that automatically selects the resolution that best fits with the semantic information. So if we have, for instance, these semantic partitions, this method would choose this resolution because it's the one that best fits with the semantic partitions. And then we have a single resolution co-clustering. So the last contribution is a set of coherent semantic partitions. So given the leaf partitions and also the semantic partitions, we applied the co-clustering framework and the automatic resolution selection. So we obtain a single resolution co-clustering as before, okay? So we propose a method where each cluster from the resolution is assigned the most likely labels from the semantic partitions. Therefore, here we have an example of these coherent semantic partitions. We have the multi-view sequence, the state-of-the-art results, and the coherent semantic partitions that we obtain in this way. Okay. So the experiments have been performed over six multi-view sequences. And first, let's present the results for the generic co-clustering. So there's no semantic information involved in this process, okay? So it is an object-based evaluation where the goal is to represent each object of the database with the minimum number of clusters, okay? So in this plot, we can see which is the average jacquard over the six different multi-view sequences that is achieved for different numbers of selected clusters. For instance, if we can only select one cluster and we have this implementation, we have an average jacquard of 0.62, okay? So here we compare our proposed co-clustering techniques with the other techniques from the state of the art, the co-segmentation techniques and the video segmentation techniques. Okay, so we can see that the red line that corresponds to the two-step iterative approach proposed without global optimization outperforms the rest of the techniques when few clusters, less than 8, are being used. On the other hand, another two-step architecture, but using the global optimization, the generic global optimization, that is the black line, outperforms the rest of the techniques when more than 8 clusters are considered. So here we have the results that are summarized using the area under the curve for each different data set, and also the average of these figures for the 6 different sequences. Okay, we can see that the best results are given by the two-step iterative architectures, with both with global and without global generic optimization. Okay. So and now we let's see the experiments performed regarding the semantic co-clustering. We have this brown curve that represents the best curve from the previous plot, so it's there's no semantic information here. That's this curve is for generic co-clustering, and when we include the semantic information in the global optimization, we outperform this curve and we obtain the black curve. So including the semantic information results in a significant improvement in the performance. But both of these techniques, the semantic and the generic one, are multi-resolution. So there are 22 different resolutions that are being assessed, and the points of each curve can come from different resolutions. So we have also assessed our proposed resolution selection technique. And when we automatically select a single resolution, our performance only decreases from this black line to the red line. Okay? So we have noted that we are comparing the results from just using one single resolution to the another approach where 22 different resolutions are being provided. Okay, so we have also assessed the semantic segmentation partitions. Our proposed coherent semantic partitions are represented by the horizontal red line, which slightly outperforms the state-of-the-art technique represented by the green line. Okay. So here we have some visual results for 3 of the multi-view sequences. We can see that, for generic co-clustering, okay, no semantic information is being used here. So we can see that for the chair sequence, with only one cluster, we can represent the chair quite good. But for other sequences, like the car or the coach, more clusters are required to represent the object. For instance, here we have like 4 or 5 clusters. Okay. And here we have some more qualitative results where where, for instance, in the motorbike, due to the change of the perspective from the first to the last views, we can see that the clusters changes from the first to the last views. Okay. So here I would like also to show some results about the semantic co-clustering, and with some intermediate results. Here we have the input images and the leaves partition for each of the views. This is the result from the generic co-clustering when the two-step iterative architecture is used. if we then include the global optimization, but with without semantic information, we obtain these results from here. We can see that, for instance, these two regions are now being clustered in the same cluster, so there's some increase in the performance. But if we change the global, the generic global optimization by the semantic global optimization, so introducing the semantic information, the these results are obtained. If then to if we assign then the most likely label to each cluster from these partitions, we obtain these semantic partitions, which can be compared to the state of the art results, where we can remark that some misclassified pixels that were recognized as person have been correct thanks to the spatial correlation between the different views. And here we have some more qualitative results for another sequence, the garden chair, where the chair is more accurate, the semantic segmentation, than the results obtained by the state of the art. So some more qualitative results, but with other data sets, like the ballet and breakdancers multi-view sequences, and also for the occlusion and object boundary detection data set. And to end the second part, we have drawn the following conclusions. The use of motion cues significantly improves the performance. The new resolution parameterization allows us to have a more uniform distribution of resolutions. The two-step architecture improved the performance of the original one-step architecture. Although global optimization is now feasible, there is no clear gain for generic co-clustering. However, it's useful for the semantic co-clustering. And a small decrease in performance has been achieved when the resolution selection, the automatic resolution selection technique is used. This part has been submitted to the ECCV and we are waiting for the decision. So as future work, we have considered three different lines. Extending the experiments to video data sets, such as the video segmentation benchmark and the cityscapes recently published on CBPR this year. The second line is extending the experiments to calibrated scenarios, where the use of geometric information like epipolar lines can be used to constrain the optimization problem. And I would also like to train an end-to-end convolutional neural network for this problem, for multi-view semantic segmentation. So finally, let me draw some global conclusions. Results achieved in the first part by considering new spatial configurations are now obsolete after the outstanding results achieved by deep learning techniques. That's the reason why results from deep learning techniques have been used in the second part instead of using our own results from the first part. The proposed multi-resolution co-clustering have improved state-of-the-art results for multi-view segmentation, both generic and semantic. But we should consider an end-to-end deep learning approach to achieve a more significant improvement. So fortunately or unfortunately, semantic segmentation techniques evolve really fast, so making this field very competitive and challenging. These are some publications directly related with my thesis, besides the submission to ECCP from the second part and the publication to ICIP from the first part. Also, my thesis proposal was accepted in the ACM Multimedia in 2013, and other publications not so related with the main topic of my thesis have been also achieved. So thank you very much.